So recently I had the opportunity on the heart.org, Medscape Cardiology, to carry on a conversation very similar to what we're going to talk about today, which is the guidelines in acute coronary disease. And you can listen in and see me and my friend Dr. Oman from Duke University talking specifically about the construction of guidelines and why we might see some of the differences in guidelines from the ESC guidelines to the American guidelines. And so what I'm going to do over the course of this half hour is my assignment was acute coronary syndrome guidelines best practices. Well, if you just look at the enormity of the information that comes out from the ACC/AHA guidelines on this topic, this is a daunting task. And so what I've done is divided it up into three sections to try to give you some sense of where we are in the guidelines from a process perspective. And that's what we'll start with. We'll start with the background on guidelines, the societal demands that are really pushing this. We'll talk about the process of developing guidelines. There's a lot of work going on in both the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association to come up with the best types of guidelines we possibly can. And then as we move into a discussion of what the most recent guidelines, 2012 for the non-ST elevation syndromes, 2013 for the ST elevation MI syndromes, we'll talk only about a couple of things. We'll talk about the things which I've said are really focused on PCI. We'll cover some selected issues of antithrombotic therapies, largely focusing on what was updated this last go-around of the non-ST elevation guidelines. And in the ST segment elevation guidelines, we'll talk about process of care, which is, I think, one of the most important things that was added to the guidelines. So as I think about guidelines, and particularly in our country where we're not as advanced as your country, and we're still struggling with how to think about delivering health care to all of our citizens, it's pretty clear with the Affordable Care Act that quality and accountability are going to be key components of health care in the United States. And this fits well with how we think about guidelines. Unfortunately, at the same time, and you know this, and I know this now even more than I did a few years ago when I used to mostly hang out with cardiologists, and now I hang out with a larger group of people across the many specialties of medicine. In cardiology, we're really actually quite blessed. We have great guidelines that guide a lot of what we do. But unfortunately, that's not the case for most of the rest of medicine. And most of the rest of medicine actually has a fairly low quality of evidence that guides clinical decision making. And I'll try to touch upon some of that. I'll show you some data that I think remains pertinent today, that guidelines-based care is quality care. And then we'll talk about this notion of combining evidence-based practice and practice-based evidence and trying to understand how we, in a real-time way, using electronic health records, can continue to get the best, most up-to-date information to help make decisions for our patients. Well, this is just looking at our country and one of the big issues as to why we needed to be guided through something like the Affordable Care Act. We have tremendous variation in the way we practice medicine in the United States. This is one of many examples I should have shown you, showing the variation in per capita spending. If you look just at our Medicare population, which are patients over the age of 65, the average Medicare recipient in the state of Florida costs the government about $16,000 per year. That's more than twice what it costs anywhere else in the country. And so you ask yourself, why is that? Are patients in Florida sicker? Do they get different types of care? Well, they're not necessarily sicker, but they do get very different types of care, and that care is not necessarily what's needed, and it causes some of these great variations in care. We know, this is work from my colleague Eric Peterson that was listed as one of the American Heart Association's top 10 discoveries that year. And this was the first time in cardiovascular medicine we really saw the true quantitative link between guideline adherence and outcome, in this case, mortality. And what this paper very nicely shows is that for every 10% increase in guidelines adherence, we see a corresponding numerical decrease in mortality. Now you'd say, well, is that a big deal? If you look at the hospitals who were the low-performing hospitals, and this is not on fancy stuff. This is not the kind of cases that Don was just showing us. This is, did you get aspirin? Did you get an ACE inhibitor? Did you get a beta blocker when you had your acute coronary event? There's a difference of about 2 lives per 100 in outcome between the low-performing hospitals and the high-performing hospitals. Think about that. 2 lives per 100 in a syndrome that in the U.S. accounts for about 1.5 million hospital admissions a year. So you can see the enormity of the public health issue. In the U.S., we're also seeing a shift away from what providers want to do to what the patients want us to do. And there's a new agency in the United States which sits outside the government, although it does have support from the government, called PCORI, really thinking about patient-centered outcomes in terms of research, the delivery of care. And one of the things you're starting to see in the guidelines is addition of patients and patient advocacy groups to the writing panels, so that we can actually understand how do patients value trade-offs. What are the individual values and preferences they bring to the table that cause them to reflect differently about thrombotic risk versus bleeding risk? Patients may differ in that regard, and now the guidelines are needing to start to do that. The guidelines are also starting to address the issue of what I call A versus B, or as my colleague Rob Califf calls Coke versus Pepsi, the notion of comparative effectiveness. What is actually better? For the most part, our guideline writers have just put out there, well, there's this trial, there's that trial, this is how it all adds up, and have avoided the question of one thing might be better than another. And so you start to see now in the guidelines that there's very direct statements around this issue of comparative effectiveness, which is new this last go-around in the guidelines. In the United States, the American Board of Internal Medicine has embarked on a large campaign called Choosing Wisely. Choosing Wisely is a campaign to take the best evidence from guidelines from a variety of subspecialties, not the least of which is cardiology, but take a variety of guideline recommendations and really engage both providers and the patient community in a conversation about things that we ought to be doing and things that we ought not to be doing. And this is an attempt in our country to try to deal with some of the variation in care issues, engaging in an educational way, letting patients know when something actually works, and letting patients know when something doesn't work or when the evidence is lacking. And there's a whole series of educational tools from the ABIM as to how we should be doing this. All of which I've mentioned as background now fits with what the Institute of Medicine in the United States have called quality care, care that's timely, effective, equitable, safe, cost-effective, and patient-centered. And so as we see that in our country, that's led to a conversation around how do you actually incorporate guidelines into your practice, and how do you use the evidence from your own practice to better inform guidelines. This is the notion of practice-based evidence. And so in our country, there's been a big push towards what's called the learning healthcare system, where we can actually, in a very continuous, cyclic way, try to understand how do we take the best external information that's available, apply it to the care of our patients, continuing to monitor, to measure what's going on in their lives and the outcome of their diseases or their procedures, feed that back in a way, in a very rigorous quantitative way. And what's making this possible now is the widespread use of electronic health records throughout the United States. Could you move me to the next slide? So as I made note that in cardiology, we've been fortunate to have a lot of good guidelines, a lot of good evidence to support those guidelines. Despite that, in the United States, we're in the ACC/AHA guidelines, that even in the best of situations, we have insufficient information as to make decisions based on the highest level of evidence, which is level of evidence A. In the area that I'm going to talk to about today, unstable angina, non-ST elevation MI, as well as ST segment elevation MI, what you can see is that while we've done a good job of collecting evidence, we still have a long way to go. And as I said earlier, cardiology is far, far ahead of most of the rest of medicine. The Institute of Medicine has then put forward acknowledging that we need all of this done to provide our patients with better care, has put forward a series of documents on how do we trust our clinical practice guidelines. The ACC and the HA has adopted the Institute of Medicine approach to the construction of guidelines. And what you now see in the preambles to the guideline are very specific descriptions of how these guideline panels were assembled, how they reviewed the evidence, and how they arrived at their decision making. Just this past year, the ACC and the HA held a methodology summit to really talk about the issues of how do we modernize the guidelines to bring us to this era of patient-centeredness in an era of full transparency of how we look at the evidence. And so with that as a background of how we're thinking about the guidelines now, let me walk you through some of the key statements in the non-ST elevation syndrome guidelines first, and then the ST segment elevation guidelines. As I said, from the United States perspective, this remains an enormous public health problem with almost 1.6 million hospital admissions a year in the United States. We see about the same number, about 1.5 million admissions for the two syndromes in Europe. This is a global problem. This is a problem that, in terms of absolute numbers, continues to increase. In 2012, we saw the update of the non-ST elevation syndrome guidelines, which were updating the 2007 guidelines. The 2014 guidelines are now going through peer review as we speak, and those guidelines should appear sometime later this year, which will update the 2012 version. In 2012, comparative effectiveness was added, as I said, to the consideration of the guidelines. And on the slides that you'll see from the ACC, and you can download these slides from the ACC or the HA websites, they put a little flag on it when they're pointing out what was modified in that version. And this go around, what was modified is very specific statements when there is head-to-head data available that one thing might be preferred over another. The thing that hasn't changed in the evaluation of acute chest pain is that all decision-making flows from the history followed by the electrocardiogram. And in the patient with ST segment elevation, the overwhelming focus of the guidelines is how to address the issue of rapid reperfusion. In the non-ST segment elevation cohort, as you all know, this is a much more complex group of patients with a lot more comorbidity and a lot more variability about what that presentation might be, from very low-risk patients, perhaps even without obstructive epicardial coronary disease, to very high-risk patients in cardiogenic shock. So let's hit some of the issues that are germane to interventional cardiology in the field of ACS, and we'll start with antiplatelet therapy. Largely, the guidelines left intact the notion that all of our patients should be receiving aspirin. We'll come back to some of the dosing issues in a moment. But what we then see is as they talk about a ADP blocker, either one of the dienapyridines like clopidogrel or prasugrel, or the newer agents like ticagrelor, you're starting to see some of the differences that they're parsing out from the trials that were done with regard to dose, the patient populations that can or should be treated, and patient populations that should be avoided. The big focus on using antiplatelet therapy is really thinking about what is the risk of the patient? And in the group of patients with non-ST elevation syndromes, high-risk patients, medium-risk patients, everything down to the lowest-risk group of patients seem to benefit from dual antiplatelet therapy, largely with aspirin and an ADP blocker, though you'll see that at the time of PCI, the 2B3A inhibitors remain in the guidelines. But the strength of that recommendation, if you follow the guidelines over the last 15 years, has really been downgraded over the years as evidence has emerged that perhaps the 2B3 inhibitors are not as valuable in reducing the risk of ischemic complications of the procedure in these patients when dual antiplatelet therapy with aspirin ADP inhibitor is already on board. Likewise, if you're going to treat your patients conservatively, they've now specifically honed in on the fact that prasugrel has not been studied in that group of patients at this iteration of the guidelines. I think we will see some commentary on prasugrel in the next go around the guidelines because of the presentation of the trilogy results. The loading doses are all put in here, and where you'll see some of the loading doses are taken directly from the main clinical trials that were done. Some of the loading doses have been evolved over the years. So, for example, clopidogrel has moved from a loading dose of 300 milligrams to a loading dose recommendation of 300 to 600 milligrams to now a more firm recommendation of 600 milligrams in the setting of patients undergoing coronary intervention. You can also see, in light of the trials, the use of prasugrel or ticagrelor in this regard. You also see that there's been a number of things which have been downgraded into a 2B recommendation, which means that there's equipoise in the field, but largely the evidence is recommending against that use. So while there may be times that it's reasonable to do it, a 2B usually reflects that you should not do this routinely. And then the guideline writers in the last iteration of the guidelines have really focused on the class 3 recommendations, but now parsing that a bit further to say the class 3 recommendations, which are things we should not be doing, they tell you why. It's either because of no benefit, in the case of, for example, low-risk patients, or it's telling you, in the case of prasugrel in patients with a history of a stroke or TIA, that there may be associated harm. Again, I think the guideline writers have done a good job with interpreting that evidence. In the anticoagulant field, it's actually a lot more straightforward in the guidelines. The 1A recommendation is use an anticoagulant in patients with acute coronary syndrome. Which one to use, because there's been few head-to-head trials in the same disease setting, they parse it a bit more and talk about whether it's conservative treatment or interventional treatment, that one anticoagulant might be better than another. But largely the message from the guideline writers on anticoagulant therapy is use one of them. Likewise, in the conservative versus the invasive strategy, what they're trying to get us to think about here from the guidelines perspective is risk. And what the guideline writers talk over and over again is that risk stratification is a dynamic process. You assess that patient when they come in. Patients with high-risk clinical features, patients with high-risk biomarker features appear to benefit more from an aggressive, invasive strategy than a conservative strategy. Although if patients have lower risk features and they've stabilized, they do note that an initial conservative strategy may be appropriate. And they list, again, in great detail, going through a variety of the risk scores, the TIMI risk score, the GRACE risk score, other risk scores, what pops out as the most important variables that predicts risk and predicts a benefit from the treatment. And they give us as well, for the first time, a whole series of class 3 recommendations when we should not be thinking about an interventional strategy. Finally, on revascularization, I think they've put in a very simple statement. The selection of PCR CABG as the means of revascularization of the patient with ACS should generally be based on the same consideration as those without ACS, meaning an anatomic. Once you decide to go to the cath lab because of clinical risk, the decision as to PCI or CABG is largely driven by anatomic considerations. In the long-term medical therapy, they give us some issues around long-term ADP blockers. They present to us the uncertainty in the data as to how long you should be treated with dual antiplatelet therapy. And they talk about downgrading the dose of aspirin. They've taken this recommendation from a variety of data sources, not the least of which is the interesting interaction between aspirin dose and ticagrelor in the PLATO study. They also continue to focus in 2012 on special groups of patients, including patients with chronic kidney disease. And they give a great deal of the evidence about adjusting medications, rethinking your strategy about contrast use, and how do you think about applying interventional therapies in that group of patients with chronic kidney disease. Well, let's switch for the last couple of minutes to the ST segment elevation in my population. What the guideline writers have done here in 2013 for the first time, I think, is really remarkable. They've moved the guidelines from being an individual exercise to really thinking about it as a regional and community-based approach. And they've given a class one, meaning we should do this, recommendation to the notion that we need to have systems of care. They talk about how do you set up primary PCI centers in ST segment elevation MI and what kind of patients should go to that. They recognize that antiplatelet therapy, anticoagulant therapy is essential to support primary angioplasty and ST elevation MI, and they talk about the important role of the different ADP inhibitors and what the evidence actually supports. Likewise, they talk about what's the anticoagulant, what does the data say as to which anticoagulant is best used in the setting of primary angioplasty. And they specifically call out fondaparinux from the OASIS studies, which should not be used as the sole anticoagulant in the setting of primary angioplasty based on the trial data. Now, like our country and your country, there's been a great deal of emphasis put on which of the patients that should get fibrinolysis versus primary angioplasty, which of the patients that should get fibrinolysis then be transferred, and the guideline writers go through a whole series of discussions and presentation of the evidence to understand the use of fibrinolytic therapy, as well as when do you transfer, a hot topic I know in this country, for angiography after receiving fibrinolysis. And again, importantly, for the first time in the guideline writers are now telling us it's not just about the medical therapy, it's how we think about this group of patients post-hospitalization. And they really are pushing us to think about this in a systems of care way. So I'll close with just a couple of comments. I hope that I've covered for you some of the societal demands that have given us the background on the guidelines to really think about how do you develop guidelines. We've talked about some of the choices in the non-ST segment elevation guidelines, the ST segment elevation guidelines. And what I'll tell you is that the guidelines are going to evolve enormously over the next couple of years. We now have the ability to capture huge amounts of information down to the molecular level on patients. At the same time, we have the ability to collect enormous amounts of data on an entire population. And somehow, we're going to have to figure out how to use all of this in the care of our patients. Terrific paper in JAMA last week looking at the various type of data sources which are coming to play in the so-called big data experience and trying to understand how we can utilize the data from a lot of different sources in what's, as I said, being called practice-based evidence. They're even including, and it's nice to see that people will be tweeting out from this meeting, they're now starting to be scientific research done on things like Twitter and how people are using it to share medical information. And there was an important set of papers this past year on the use of Twitter in educational activities around sudden cardiac death. So you are seeing very different types of data getting pulled into the care of our patients. And I thought being in Canada would be appropriate to close with a comment about evidence-based medicine, practice-based medicine from Dave Sackett, who said that what it really is and what it's all about in taking care of our patients and what I think is reflected in the guidelines, it's combining the best quantitative evidence about medical practice with expert judgment in an attempt to assure the provision of medical care with reproducible high quality. That's really what the best practices of guidelines are about. And so I'll leave you with that, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you very much.